Some say money matters, but my brother says big something matters more. What was that last B? Big boots, big books, big brains, that's it.
Get your head out of the gutter. Today, we're learning cranial nerves. Welcome back to another anatomy video. My name is Patrick, and just like you, I remember sitting in class trying to come up with a clever, usually inappropriate, way to remember the cranial nerves. But if I'm honest with myself, I never really understood why I was learning them. I would do the OOO to touch and feel thing, and I would do the mnemonics and I would pass the test. So my friends, by the end of this video, you'll have a couple mnemonics to help you out on the test, but more importantly, you'll understand why these nerves are so important. As always, we begin with the big picture. As the name implies, the cranial nerves pop off of the brain and brainstem, unlike the spinal nerves that you're probably familiar with. Some of them poke out of the anterior of your brain, while some of them have branches that loop all the way down into your chest. And the majority of them are involved in those big deal senses like vision and hearing. So as a clinician, there's a really good chance you're gonna have to do a cranial nerve exam at some point. Like, when I worked in sports medicine, we'd always do a cranial nerve exam as part of our concussion assessment. So, let's get you familiarized here. Here's the lateral view of your brain. This is the front or anterior, and this is the back or posterior. But this doesn't give us a super clear picture of the anatomy of interest, so we flip the skull side down and get a bottoms up view. And now that we can see them, we assign them Roman numerals based on their position from anterior to posterior. We'll go through each nerve's name and function, but now we can get our front to back logical numbering and ordering done. Okay, throughout this explanation, remember that anatomists are terrible at naming things. So most of the time, the name of the nerve is going to be a giveaway for its function. The second thing to remember is that some of these nerves are exclusively sensory, some are exclusively motor, and some are both. So I'm gonna keep a running tally of the numbers and the abbreviation that you're gonna use for their names over here, as well as whether it's sensory, motor, or both, which I'll abbreviate with an initial. Cranial nerve number one, again going anterior to posterior, is the olfactory nerve, and it's responsible for your sense of smell. And look at it, look at this thing. It looks like it's supposed to go down your nose, right? It's double true when you see where those big olfactory bulbs land in your skull. They go right on top of your nose where they shoot a bunch of smaller nerves down into the nose that then pick up on those odorants. If you had to test this clinically, obviously you're gonna have somebody close their eyes and smell something nice and familiar. Hot coffee usually does the trick because it's not too aggressive of a smell, everybody knows what it smells like, and it's not gonna give them a headache. Cranial nerve number two is the optic nerve, and it's responsible for your sense of sight. Unfortunately, when you're studying that inferior to superior view, that illustration doesn't do this nerve justice. Look, your eyes are incredibly important when it comes to dealing with incoming sensory information, right? So it totally makes sense that we'd have a big, thick nerve that's responsible for taking that information from the eyes to the brain. On that illustration, that little nub of a nerve doesn't look as important as what's really happening. But with the eyeball still attached, the optic nerve finally looks like a big, important nerve that transmits sight back to the brain. You can actually see the optic nerve if you look longingly into the eyes of your patient, shine a bright light in there, and find that spot at the back of their eye. You're looking at their optic nerve. The optic nerve is exclusively a sensory nerve. The next couple will be motor nerves for the eye. Cranial nerve number three is the big boy eyeball mover, the oculomotor nerve. And it's responsible for most of the movement of the eye. Muscles that make the eye look up, down, and in, and even raise the eyelid and constrict the pupil. But that leaves a couple of movements out, which is where cranial nerves number four and six come in. Cranial nerve four, or the trochlear nerve, handles this super specific muscle called the superior oblique muscle. This dude right here. Trochlea comes from the Latin root for pulley, and when you look at this muscle, it totally looks like a pulley. Now, assuming you're not a total etymology dork like myself, trochlea isn't gonna come to mind as easily as oculomotor would. So here's how I remember it. When you test this nerve, you'd have your patient look down and side to side, like they're looking down at a track, which is the closest thing you're gonna get to trochlear.
Y'all wanted more dad jokes. This is what you're getting.
Now, to make things more complicated, The oculomotor nerve only innervates one of the side-to-side eyeball movers, the medial rectus muscle. So cranial nerve 6, the abducens nerve, innervates the lateral rectus muscles. If you're already good with your terminology of motion, you know that abduction of a joint is when you lift a limb out to the side. Obviously, that can't happen with your eyes, so I remember this one because of the word overlap with abduction and lateral movement. On a clinical test, though, most clinicians will do the follow my finger with your eyes test to take care of cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6 at the same time. Coming back to cranial nerve 5, we have our first double dipper. It's both sensory and motor. That's because this guy, the trigeminal nerve, is actually three nerves, hence trigeminal. The first branch is the ophthalmic nerve, which is the sensory nerve for the front top part of your face. Next is the maxillary nerve, which senses everything from your upper palate, upper lip, and nasal cavity. Finally is the mandibular nerve, the biggest branch of the three, which innervates the mandible, or the jaw. The motor part of this nerve comes from the mandibular branch. If you have someone bite down on something like a tongue compressor, their masseter and temporalis muscles will flex, which is usually your test for that nerve. Cranial nerve 7 is a doozy. It's the facial nerve, and it's another one of those big branching nerve roots. Now, our trigeminal nerve already took care of a couple different motor functions around the face, but any kind of complex facial expressions are made by muscles innervated by the facial nerve. But check this out, cranial nerve 7 is a both. We just heard about its motor function, but its sensory function is so frustrating and specific, I hate it. It's responsible for taste only on the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, and because of that, you have to remember it as a both. Cranial nerve number 8 is the vestibulocochlear nerve, and it's responsible for your sense of hearing, which actually totally makes sense. We're all the way down at nerve number 8 by now, so that nerve root is close to the ear. Cranial nerve number 8 is exclusively a sensory nerve, which also makes sense. Unlike dogs, humans don't need to move their ears, so we don't have a ton of musculature around them to do that movement. There are technically some very tiny muscles within and around the ear, but they're innervated by other nerves like the facial nerve. Couple of ways to remember this one. I recommend getting your lab mate, look directly at their ear, lean in and whisper vestibulocochlear. Then they slap you in the face and the ringing in your ears will be an ever-present reminder that vestibulocochlear is responsible for hearing. Cranial nerve number 9 is the glossopharyngeal nerve, which takes care of sensation for the back third of the tongue through some of the oropharynx and motor innervation of one specific muscle. There was a lot there, so let's break it down. Anytime you see that root word glosso, think tongue. Easy to remember because the tongue is glossy because it's covered in saliva. Now, this thing also controls one tiny muscle, the stylopharyngeus muscle, this dude right here. It's called that because it connects the styloid process near your ear down to this super wide area in your throat. Another tiny motor function, but it still qualifies cranial nerve 9 as a both. The rest of the area innervated by the glossopharyngeal nerve is the pharyngeal part. And where students trip up is thinking that the pharynx is like way down your throat, but in reality, it's just inferior to your tongue. It's basically what connects the mouth to the esophagus. Next up is the vagus nerve, or cranial nerve 10. And it's the absolute superstar of the cranial nerves because it takes care of some like life or death operations. The vagus nerve is the main nerve of the parasympathetic nervous system. And if you've never heard that word before, go check out my video on it right there. Quick oversimplified answer though, the parasympathetic nervous system calms down a lot of processes while the sympathetic nervous system excites them. So if you wanted your heart rate to speed up, that's sympathetic. If you wanted it to come back down, that's parasympathetic. And that's where the vagus nerve comes in. The vagus nerve is a long boy and has a bunch of different branches, some dipping down through the diaphragm and into the stomach. Either way, it's a big sensory interface between organs like the lungs and stomach back up to the brain, but it also helps slow down heart rate. Either way, it's a big sensory interface between the brain and organs like the lungs or stomach, but it also helps slow down heart rate. The right branch of the vagus nerve partially innervates the sinoatrial node, or SA node, in your heart. This is your major built-in pacemaker that keeps your heart pumping around 60 beats per minute. Cranial nerve 11 is the accessory nerve, and it's the motor innervation for your sternocleidomastoid and your upper traps. I remember this one because you have to take your accessories like your purse or your backpack, throw it over your shoulder, and then use the muscles innervated by your accessory nerve to adjust it. Cranial nerve 12 is the hypoglossal nerve, and because you're a beautiful mind, you remember that glosso means tongue, so you're already thinking, this must be the motor control of the tongue. That's everything from up and down down and side to side, which you could use to make an H and remember hypoglossal. Now, very importantly, there is a little bit of controversy with whether we're finished right here or not. While I was never taught this one in school, enough of the sources I read mentioned it, so I thought I'd mention it here. Cranial nerve zero, or the terminal nerve. It's this little bundle of nerves near, but not attached to, the olfactory nerve. And if we're comparing it to the terminal nerve in other animals, it's the nerve that would let us sniff out pheromones. These are chemicals that in other animals help regulate sexual behavior, but in humans are almost certainly not a thing. Either way, for the terminal nerve, it might be involved in gonadotropin releasing hormone regulation, but like, you're not gonna test that during a clinical exam, so it's just kind of a nice to know. Either way, it's a fun fact. So those are the 12 to 13 cranial nerves, obviously depending on if you're gonna count the terminal nerve. And to help you remember them, you have nearly infinite mnemonics to use. Like my old undergrad professor insisted that we use this one. On old Olympic towering tops, a French and German observed some hops, which like, it worked for his brain, but it never stuck with me. Plus, some of the memory devices use slightly different naming variations. Like that professor that I just mentioned called cranial nerve 11 the spinal accessory nerve, where I call it the accessory nerve. Obviously, that's gonna change the acronym. So what I recommend is reading a bunch of the different mnemonics and figuring out which one works the best for you. Now, fair warning, some of them are clean and family friendly, and some are so dirty that they're gonna make you wanna clean your eyeballs out with bleach. Like I mentioned earlier, I'll link to the Wikipedia dedicated to cranial nerve mnemonics, and I'll put that down in the doobly-doo, but if you've got a favorite, write it in the comments and we'll upvote our favorites. Here's my pro tip though. You're probably gonna know ahead of time what day your cranial nerve test is gonna be on. So when you go into your test with your mnemonic locked and loaded in your brain, write it out first thing in the margin so you can come back to it and not freak out when you're midway through the test and you're under pressure. A lot of your cranial nerves are input points for four of your five major senses. So I'm gonna recommend this video as a follow-up to this one. It's a high-level view of how your different senses work. Or you can check out my nervous system playlist right here. I also want to give a shout out to all my patrons on Patreon. You can join them by clicking right here, or you can support the channel for free by clicking this link right here, liking the video, or leaving a comment. Have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.